wacko, freak, child molester. You change your skin from black to white. You're a weirdo.
In his lifetime, Michael Jackson was labeled everything imaginable. But maybe he wasn't as weird as we thought, but a perfectly normal customer of services in Hollywood. Services on offer to every A-list star, private eyes, gangsters, mystics and cults, who become your new family and make big problems go away at a price.
The Hollywood underbelly stinks. It reeks.
They come with fangs like werewolves. You know, like vampires.
Everyone in Michael Jackson's life was out to use him.
Michael Jackson's secret Hollywood holds the secret to who Jackson really was. The product of a system that created him, fed on him, and ultimately destroyed him. Beyond the grave, Michael Jackson is about to sign to a new Hollywood agent. The most powerful man in town, with a client list unlike any other. Mark Rosler doesn't need Swish LA offices to impress his clients, because they're all dead. I'm journalist Jack Peretti. And I'd always thought that Michael Jackson would be remembered for the child abuse allegations. But he's not. This year, he's the hottest property in Hollywood.
Good morning.
Hello. Is that Mark?
It's Mark.
I imagine. Hi. Nice to meet you. So these are all the pictures you've got of all your clients on the wall.
This is a Marilyn Merlot wine.
Wow.
And you can pour it in your Marilyn Merlot Andy Warhol wine glass.
Mark pioneered the Dead Celebrity Agency and makes millions of dollars every year putting his clients' names and faces to everything imaginable.
This is good. What's this?
A Maryland purse. We've done hundreds of Maryland purses over the years. Those sold for about $1,000 when they were made. Elvis telephone right here.
Mark signed Dead Elvis in the 80s when Elvis's career was at a low point and never looked back.
A musical hound dog of Elvis. Probably worth quite a bit of money today.
Last year, Elvis earned $60 million.
What about Michael Jackson?
Well, I would rather not publicly comment on any discussions I've had with the Jackson estate, but obviously with who we are and what services we offer, there have been different discussions with different people.
Jackson died in Hollywood, but he was created and destroyed by Hollywood too. It began in 1969 when the Jackson family moved from the Midwest. Michael was enrolled at California Prep, an exclusive private school of just 90 pupils for kids of the Hollywood elite. The Brandos, the Sonny and Shares, and now the Jacksons. Sitting next to Michael at school was child star Danny Bonaducci from sitcom The Partridge Family. He's agreed to talk to me about the Hollywood that created Jackson and produced as many casualties as stars.
This is my actual yearbook picture. Also in the bees, there's Christian Brando, who is no longer with us. But Michael Jackson.
There's Michael. You had a class of three, and that was you guys.
Yeah, that was the entire 12th grade at Cal Prep. It was me, Christian Brando, and Michael Jackson. But I went to school with all the Jacksons. Went from 7th to 12th grade. And they were a wonderful family. Some of them had their quirks, but some of them did not at all. Michael couldn't have been a more normal guy.
but Michael had left his classmates behind, plotting a bright new future away from his family and the Jackson Five. Jackson's friend and attorney, Brian Oxman, was with Michael throughout his career, and Michael would confide in him until the very end.
He wanted to break away from the influence of his family. He wanted his freedom. He wanted to be the maestro who conducted his entertainment, performance, life. He was to be boss, and he didn't want anybody else to tell him what to do.
Michael left his family behind, and his first solo album, Off the Wall, sold 20 million copies. In the vacuum left behind by his family, Hollywood Services would now step in to support him. He was on top of the world, but one day Jackson bumped into someone from his past and got a glimpse into his own future.
And I'm standing, and this limousine comes to a screeching halt. The window comes down, and it's Michael Jackson. And he looks at me and he goes, "Danny, how are you?" And I went, "I'm great, Michael. How are you?" And you could see I was a train wreck. He knew I wasn't okay. And he went, "Well, you look good. It's really good to see you." And I said, "You too, Michael. Congratulations on all the success tied to the biggest star in the world." And he waved as he walked down the street. And I watched the limousine go by to the biggest star in the world, who had the exact same brakes I did. You know, he had the exact same life I did. And I thought, how did that not end up being me? Why is it him instead of me? And I'd like to say that's when I went home and sobered right up. But it took about 5 seconds for me to go, "That sucks." And I crossed right across the street and bought the drugs.
Hollywood caters for two worlds, stardom and self-destruction. What Jackson didn't realize was that he was about to cross from his world into Danny's. With Hollywood, his new family, there to hold his hand every step of the way. At the 1984 Grammys, Jackson won a record 8 awards for Thriller. In his moment of triumph, he was blissfully unaware of his imminent downfall. After Thriller, Jackson prepared for his next extravaganza, an advert for Pepsi.
It was to be a blockbuster. That commercial was a life-defining experience that altered his very soul.
During the filming of the Pepsi ad, Michael suffered serious burns to his scalp when a firework exploded early. Overnight, he went from a global megastar to a burns victim in a wheelchair. People emerged from the shadows in masks with pills and needles to provide a new Hollywood service and to become his new family. Here in suburbia, Barbara Maywood holds the key to the next stage of Michael Jackson's life. She was an assistant to Dr. Hoffman, one of the most powerful plastic surgeons in Hollywood, and part of Jackson's secret life of surgery.
Hi, is that Barbara?
I am Barbara.
I'm Jack.
You're Jack?
Nice.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. Oh, who are these?
These are Sarah and Beckett, but yeah, my family, if you will.
Yes.
Michael was, you know, super, super special, kind and thoughtful, you know, and I've got all kinds of things from the ranch and pictures and...
So, Barbara, do you remember the day when Michael's hair caught fire during the filming of a Pepsi ad?
I remember I was on the 101 freeway, and there was an announcement on the radio that Michael was having his surgery that morning, and I said, "Nah, if this traffic doesn't clear up, he's not having any surgery because all the instruments are in the back of my car." It was pretty intense, getting into the operating room, bodyguard in the operating room, one on the outside of the operating room. I mean, it was a kick. It was kind of a kick.
He has both second and third degree burns of the scalp. It takes several months for the complete healing process to take place.
After the accident, Jackson put his trust in Barbara's boss, Dr. Hoffman, who defined what Hollywood looked like. He lifted the face of an entire town, architect of the necropolis, city of the living dead.
He invited me to a party that was for nothing but facial plastic surgeons. And people just sat around going, oh, those are Dave's lips for sure. Yeah, those are Dave's lips. Dave did those. Oh, Jimmy did that nose. That's a Jimmy nose for sure. I mean, they're almost like playing a parlor game. Pick out whose body part was done by what doctor. Wow. It's really weird.
This is Fenton Bailey, top Hollywood producer. He's worked with stars from Pamela Anderson to Macaulay Culkin and has seen how the Hollywood system really works from the inside.
The plastic surgeon in Hollywood is the closest thing to God that there actually is. You know, he's taking out ribs and carving people up and sculpting them in his own image. And to have that power, to have a star laid out unconscious in front of you, they've given up all their power. They cannot do anything. They are completely in your hands as you get out the knife. That must be kind of a pretty heady rush. And you must feel that you are a kind of god if you're that plastic surgeon.
Michael put his face, his career, and his trust in the hands of Dr. Hoffman. But was this trust in Hollywood's medical service? In 1999, Barbara sued Dr. Hoffman. In those proceedings, she alleged she saw him fondle and joke about Jackson's penis during surgery, even faking surgery on him by turning the clocks forward. She also claimed she saw Sly Stallone march into his girlfriend's breast surgery and demand Hoffman put in bigger implants without her knowledge.
That trust has been abused a lot by a surgeon.
I really can't go there. Cut. I know who you're talking about. It was there. I can't. You lay it down.
Hoffman vehemently denied these allegations.
Issue.
An out-of-court settlement prevents Barbara from repeating her claims on camera.
The stress of having to see what you saw and then keep a lid on it.
Very hard. But doing what you can to stop it and not being able to. I always tell patients I only work in the kitchen. I don't own the restaurant. So that's basically what it was.
In his lifetime, everyone believed that Jackson was addicted to surgery, but he wasn't. He was addicted to the painkillers he got from surgery. Got his prescription drugs perfectly legitimately at a high street chemist, Mickey Fine, a Beverly Hills institution since 1962. This is how the Hollywood Prescription Drug Service works in one building. The shop front is a diner, but behind the glass is the important business of pills. Going to the pharmacy is not necessary for Hollywood's biggest stars. They can use Mickey Fine's home delivery service. John drives a little van full of uppers and downers up and down the Hollywood Hills all day long. In the wake of Jackson's death, Mickey Fine Pharmacy was raided and cleared of any wrongdoing. They're just providing a legitimate service for the doctors who prescribe these drugs.
It is a scandal. If that doctor refuses to give that prescription, he's no longer going to see that patient, not going to see Michael Jackson anymore. He can't speak up. So it's a terrible catch-22.
Okay, it's called doctor shopping. Okay, so you got to get 10 different doctors. It's a very time-consuming thing, but it works.
Michael had his various doctors, and it wasn't just in Beverly Hills. It was all across the country that he would pick up medications from those physicians.
Despite his attempts to get clean, Jackson had an even greater dependency on the people around him. a growing entourage of advisors, doctors, lawyers and fixers.
You have to have an entourage. You've got to have a publicist. You've got to have a manager. You've got to have an agent. And then from there, the bench just gets bigger and deeper. You know, you need an acupuncturist. You need a dietitian. You need a massage therapist. Oh, you need a therapist for sure. Maybe several. Maybe you need, you know, Kabbalah. You know, there are all these people, gardeners, landscapers, interior designers, very important, florist. You know, all these people who become your sort of entourage. The only thing is, you are paying them. So suddenly all your friends are a business that you have to support and that you have to keep working and have to keep generating more and more money to keep their expectations satisfied as well.
Behind the walls of the compound, nothing is safe. Nothing is safe. You can have up all the walls you want. The second you let somebody in, you've let somebody in that can profit from knowing on you. Knowing what happens behind the walls at an A-lister start is valuable, and it's an occupation.
Meet Bobby Trendy, Michael Jackson's former interior designer, and the ultimate object lesson in how the entourage really works. Bobby started in Hollywood in Anna Nicole Smith's entourage, then the most famous Playboy centerfold since Marilyn Monroe.
Before I came here, I saw Anna Nicole Smith on TV. She was beautiful. Her hair was shiny like glass. Her lips are just perfectly heart-shaped. Everyone wanted to be Anna Nicole Smith.
As she unraveled on prescription drugs 2 years before Michael Jackson, Bobby rose to become chief confidant.
As things were getting worse, as the slow motion train crash was kind of taking place, that people walked away.
More people wanted to be around her. Vultures, I call them.
But it took Anna Nicole Smith's death for Bobby to fulfill his destiny.
Friends say, Bobby, you are the real Anna Nicole Smith. And it was exciting that I became her, you know? I have fancy clothes to wear now. I have diamond rings to wear. I have a nice car to drive. Everything that Anna embodied, I now have.
This is how natural selection worked in the Hollywood entourage. To become the next in line, you must ultimately consume the host. In Jackson's ever-expanding entourage, people weren't just making moves. They all wanted a piece of him.
Every time he turned around, somebody else had their hands in the cookie jar. The greed, the theft that was taking place around him was so enormous. He could not control it. He couldn't do anything about it. He never figured it out. He said to me one time, he says, Brian, I hire the people that steal from me the least. I don't want to hire people who steal from me a lot.
Jackson made a radical decision to deal with the problem. Nothing short of a Stalinist purge of the people around him at all levels. Jackson wanted total control over the rank and file. He culled his top-level management and appointed a new manager. Dieter Weisner was not part of the Hollywood system. He wasn't even American. I wanted to find out why Michael had turned to this man above all others.
It's odd. It's an odd place to come. It's a kind of run-down industrial estate in Frankfurt. This is him.
Dieter Weisner was an unlikely manager for Jackson, a German entrepreneur with no track record in the music business whatsoever.
Hi, I'm Jack.
Hi.
Hi, nice to meet you. Thanks for your time.
You're welcome.
All right.
So, that's my office.
It's like a shrine to Michael Jackson.
Dieter first met Jackson by chance, pitching him an isotonic drink to endorse Mystery, kind of Jacko Red Bull. It never went into production.
He asked you to come in to the court. So what happened there?
He told me to get rid of everybody.
So he was asking to get rid of basically people who'd been the old entourage.
Exactly. He changed even his bodyguards. he changed everybody. We had a new accountant. We had new lawyers around him. We had everything. We created everything, and it was really, really good.
Jackson asked Dieter to come up with a plan for his future. It was to be called MJ Universe.
We created it already.
This was your idea, wasn't it? MJ Universe.
And Dieter was tasked with making it happen.
Can you just talk me through what the MJ Universe was actually going to look like?
Mentor program, that music project, film projects, game projects, new technology. Neverland 2 in Vegas.
This is incredible.
He knew exactly what he wants. So the problem was Hollywood and the people over there didn't give him a chance for this at all.
Jackson had turned to the services of an outsider who was not part of the Hollywood family, and their plan stalled.
I had a feeling that I was not welcome at all. There was people over there, they called me Hitler. And I think this is wrong. I had nothing to do with Hitler.
Jackson had turned his back on Hollywood services. He was about to discover he couldn't survive without them. In 1993, a scandal was brewing, and Jackson would need to turn to the people in the shadows who make Hollywood's problems go away, whatever it takes.
The newest voice in cable news is on the New News Network.
It is an independent, progressive voice, and I love that.
Jennifer Granholm joins Current TV, a former two-term governor.
People like somebody who's got a spine.
Determined to find solutions.
We need government to ensure that people have freedom.
Driven to find the truth.
What's really going on?
Fearless, independent, and above all, politically direct. The War Room with Jennifer Granholm, tonight at 9, 8 Central on Current TV.
I remember the day my doctor told me I have an irregular heartbeat and that it put me at 5 times greater risk of a stroke.
Michael Jackson stands accused of an extraordinary catalogue of offences.
The star is accused of abusing a 13-year-old boy. He's dropped out of sight after revealing his addiction to painkillers.
Trying to see the unraveling of Michael Jackson.
In 1993, Michael Jackson was accused of having sex with this 13-year-old boy called Geordie Chandler. Allegations made by his father, Evan Chandler. When things go wrong for major Hollywood stars, a massive cleanup operation is launched by the people you never hear about, who offer a bespoke Hollywood service to make all your problems go away. Jackson turned to the services offered by this man, Paul Baresi, a private eye known in Hollywood as the Enforcer.
I will go in your trash can and get an entire profile on you. I'll find out what your medications are, where you bank, where you shop, if you're having an affair. You'd be amazed what I can find in a trash can. The Hollywood underbelly stinks. It reeks. Sometimes you want to puke. That's how bad it is.
This is the corner of Curson and Santa Monica, and this is where Eddie Murphy picked up the Samoan transvestite. He claimed that she was in distress, and he, being the good Samaritan that he is, offered to help her.
Baresi's work for Eddie Murphy's attorney made his reputation.
Eddie Murphy was the driver of the vehicle, and the passenger was arrested for a prostitution warrant.
All of the transvestites came out of the woodwork alleging that they had sexual relations with Eddie Murphy. What I did for Eddie was I rounded up all of these transsexuals, and I helped them all see their way clear to recanting their story. And the one that I didn't manage to pay off fell to her death from this building right here. I can tell you this, that I didn't have a hand in it.
Baresi is a lightning rod for all the filth in Hollywood. He'll clean up or discredit a star depending on who pays him first. When the Geordie Chandler scandal hit, Barresi started in the anti-Jackson camp. He was approached by Jackson's cook and cleaner, Stella and Philippe Lamarck, with a story to sell.
He said, look, we saw Jackson molesting Macaulay Culkin. Well, what did he do? We saw him groping Macaulay Culkin over his pants. What I did for Eddie was I rounded up all of these transsexuals and I helped them all see their way clear to recanting their story. And the one that I didn't manage to pay off fell to her death from this building right here. I can tell you this, that I didn't have a hand in it.
Barresi is a lightning rod for all the filth in Hollywood. He'll clean up or discredit a star depending on who pays him first. When the Geordie Chandler scandal hit, Barresi started in the anti-Jackson camp. He was approached by Jackson's cook and cleaner, Stella and Philippe Lamarck, with a story to sell.
He said, look, we saw Jackson molesting Macaulay Culkin. Well, what did he do? We saw him groping Macaulay Culkin over his pants. They said, we want 100 grand. I got him 100,000 on the table, cash, from the Inquirer. It took me 3 days to do it, but by then they met an attorney and said, look, I can get you $500,000. Forget about Barresi. And this time they said that they saw Michael Jackson not groping Macaulay Culkin outside the pants, but the hand went inside the pants now. The
story had got better.
The story they embellished and they lied, you know? They just lied, flat out lied.
Yeah.
And I recorded it.
Barresi was about to play the classic Hollywood double cross. He went straight to Jackson's camp to a man called Anthony Pellicano, who was masterminding Jackson's attempt to kill the scandal by discrediting or paying off anyone with allegations. Anthony Pellicano in Hollywood as the Sin Eater, so called because he once said, I eat their sins so they can stand on the red carpet smiling.
And Pellicano said, this is going to be very helpful to Jackson.
Right.
Because it discredited Stella and Philippe.
You've switched sides now. You're like, this could bring Jackson down, but now this could save Jackson instead.
That's right.
The Lamarck's allegations were now discredited, and Macaulay Culkin has always denied these events took place. To deal with Evan Chandler's accusations, Pellicano did the same thing and secretly recorded him.
If I go through with this, I win big time. I get everything I want. They will be destroyed forever.
Pellicano wasted no time in making his evidence public. Although discredited, Chandler was paid $22 million for telling his story. Because this is the Hollywood way. Pellicano was hired by other top Hollywood players, like Michael Ovitz, the head of Disney, to collect evidence against his enemies. And by comedian Chris Rock, when a model tried to extort money from him after sex.
I'm better off getting caught with needles in my arm.
Don't worry about it, dude. You're not going to get no blow to the career. I'm not going to let it happen.
When Courtney Love was in dispute with the Nirvana estate, she made a call.
I'm an old-style Sicilian. One way. My clients are my family, and I'm very heavy-handed, honey.
I need heavy-handed, baby.
Nothing that was done for Jackson was out of the ordinary. It was a Hollywood service, as every day and routine as having your pool cleaned. In 1994, after Michael Jackson's empire had been rocked by child abuse allegations, he'd survived, but needed to shore up his public image. And for this, he turned to another trusted Hollywood service, the celebrity wedding. He married Lisa Marie Presley, an openly devout Scientologist.
Did you ever have any experience of Scientologists trying to get Michael to join the church?
Michael was solicited by the Church of Scientology over and over and over again. They wanted contributions and money from him. I believe I remember seeing him make some contributions.
Do you think they were close to securing a deal with Michael?
No, they were never close to security. They tried, but it never happened. Not when I was there.
Right.
In a town where you can trust no one, cults are the complete opposite of what they appear.
These things that are considered cults by some people are really kind of your new family. Your old family and your old friends have kind of abandoned you. You've outgrown them. They're jealous. Whatever the reasons are, the Scientologists often seem very stable to me. I don't see the crime.
Perhaps if Jackson had signed to Scientology, he would have had support during the child abuse allegations. More than he got from his own sister, LaToya, who publicly denounced him. Joining a cult in Hollywood is not a crackpot side effect of being famous. It's a sensible insurance policy. You look after the cult, and they look after you. Avowed Scientologist Tom Cruise became a worldwide laughingstock after a madcap appearance in 2005 on The Oprah Winfrey Show and lost his studio deal with Paramount.
So when Cruise had his kind of mad couch moment, people were looking like they were going to walk away from him. People in Hollywood.
They did walk away. They ran away from him.
But the Scientologists were there.
Absolutely, they were there.
Cults provide a genuine surrogate family in the flaky and highly paranoid world of Hollywood. When Jackson's marriage to Lisa Marie Presley failed in 1996, he had no cult to turn to. So instead, he turned to a building he knew well, to a small office leading from the back of Mickey Fine's pharmacy, to Dr. Arnold Klein, Jackson's dermatologist. Klein offered Jackson a bespoke Hollywood service for every conceivable need, from surgical fillers to skin cream, and a new wife with no strings attached. Debbie Rowe was Klein's assistant and carried Jackson's first two kids, Prince Michael and Paris, signing away all her custody rights up front. It's reported that Klein's services didn't stop there. He even allegedly donated his own sperm and remained evasive about whether it was for Michael when later questioned. But outside, in the real world, his entourage was ballooning again. And it was someone from within his entourage who would bring the whole thing crashing down.
An arrest warrant for Mr. Jackson has been issued on multiple counts of child molestation.
In 2003, a second wave of child abuse allegations hit. A 13-year-old called Gavin Arviso and his family claimed Jackson had molested him.
It was 2 o'clock in the morning, and I saw on my cell phone that it was the ranch calling me, and I answered, hello. There was no answer. Hello. And then I would hear, he was crying. I said, Michael, it's okay, it's okay. And he says, why, Brian? Why are they doing this to me?
Michael was taken to court on 5 counts of child molestation. But the reason it went to trial was not to do with child abuse. It was because of this man inside Michael's inner circle, Mark Schaffel, a film producer.
Part of the entourage was someone called Mark Schaffel, who was a videographer. Is that correct?
He made something for Michael, yeah?
What was it?
What can I give?
Do you know anything about Mark Schaffel's career at all?
I heard a lot, of course.
That he produced gay porn films?
That's right.
In the past, under the alias of Mark Fredericks, Schaffel had directed such gay classics as View to a Thrill and Cocktails.
Michael freaked out when he came close to him. Right. Michael told me, do you know what he did?
You employed Mark.
No, I didn't.
The relationship with Mark Schaffel is what ultimately the source of the charges which were brought against Michael Jackson. The reason why Michael Jackson was indicted was because of the connection that these people had to the pornography industry. And the things that were on their computers were disgusting when the police seized them. It was the prosecution's belief that they could connect these people and make their sins Michael Jackson's sins.
Jackson's trusted manager, Dieter Weisner, was also caught up in the scandal when prosecutors named him, alongside Mark Schaffel and three others, as unindicted co-conspirator for his dealings with the Arvizo family. This rebounded on Jackson. Now the police were building a case.
Everyone in Hollywood, every aspect of the business, is in some manner connected to the pornography industry.
It's an absolute labyrinthine nightmare, isn't it?
This is the lecture that Michael Jackson gave me. They're all manipulators. They're all out for themselves. They all want a piece of me. Everyone in Michael Jackson's life was out to use him.
Jackson, though acquitted, was finished. But Schaffel wasn't. He moved from Jackson's entourage to Jackson's ex-wife, Debbie Rowe, as her unofficial agent. After 2005, as the darkness closed in, Jackson looked for someone to trust, a soulmate in a city without a soul. But Hollywood had other ideas.
This is it. This is it.
In 2009, Michael Jackson performed for the last time in front of a live audience. But behind the scenes, he was still secretly addicted to painkillers.
He was treated like he was kind of a pack animal, some kind of a racehorse, where his only purpose in life, his only existence, was to make money for other people. He was given drug after drug after drug to pump him up.
As a last resort, the Jackson camp turned to a service offered high up in the Hollywood Hills. By this man, Dr. Howard Samuels, the high priest of Hollywood rehab. This is the place where Lindsay Lohan came and tried to clean up. Like everything in Hollywood, this is rehab with a difference.
This is one of our houses. One of the things that is so very important is we want to seduce people in coming into treatment.
Right.
You know, beautiful pool, beautiful house, beautiful views. This is the main house. Here, this is the kitchen here. You know, this is all part of the community atmosphere. This is a double room. You know, they wake up at 7:30 in the morning. They make their beds. They put away their clothes.
It's like they're children, isn't it?
Absolutely. You know what I get? You. Have somebody else do it. I didn't come here. I didn't pay all this money to, you know, make my own bed.
In the past, rehab was about shaming the celebrity into sobriety. Elizabeth Taylor was made to clean the toilets at the Betty Ford Clinic.
This here is a work that one of our clients did. He's very creative.
But he doesn't look that happy, does he?
Yeah.
Now it's about seducing them into treatment. And the boundaries are more blurred.
Do you ever become friends with patients?
Yes, but after about a year, you know, I can get closer to them after a period of time.
Do you not think that's inappropriate?
Right away it would be, but after a year or two, no.
Rehab once stood outside the system, but now it's part of the matrix of Hollywood services. featherbedding celebrities by allowing them to come and go and even take their prescription antidepressants.
I know people who will check into a rehab and they will pay the $40,000 for the 30-day stay and they're not really addicted to anything. Wouldn't you have paid 40 grand to see Michael Jackson spill his guts every day for 30 days?
Yeah, because then you can come out and sell your story.
Which they did, often. And at AA meetings in Hollywood, I know of two meetings where I believe 30% of the crowd, in a packed crowd at certain meetings, I don't believe that they even drink.
Michael Jackson knew there was no safety in Hollywood, not even in rehab. There was no hiding place left from the beast. As the concerts that would kill him approached, Jackson shunned rehab and his entourage. Instead, he had a driver take him out to visit a rundown district of LA. To meet Reverend June Gatlin, a spiritualist.
Anoint you, Sir Jack.
Why, out of all the people in the world, did he turn to this woman? A real-life version of Whoopi Goldberg in Ghost. Like everyone in Hollywood, June has her own entourage. Ladies from the church keen to document our visit. But first, we have to set the mood.
And he wrote here, today was like being baptised in the sea of life. Mm-hmm. I love you, Michael Jackson.
Yeah, that would be good.
But first, we have to set the mood.
And he wrote here, today was like being baptised in the sea of life. Mm-hmm. I love you, Michael Jackson. Mm-hmm. He didn't have many people he could trust, but he turned to you and he asked you for advice.
I know he could trust me because I wasn't in awe. You know, I wasn't kissing his feet or pulling at the hem of his garment.
Did you sense that he was in trouble?
That he was going to die?
Mm.
Yeah, I knew he was going to die. Individuals that are thieves, individuals who are determined to murder a spirit, they come with fangs like werewolves, you know, like vampires. Yes. Yes.
Yes. June understood Jackson because, like him, June had been a child star, not in music or film, but in the church.
People would gravitate towards me, and when they touched me, they would feel better. I didn't, because I could feel life being pulled off me. It's like somebody drawing your energy off you, you know, and it's like, wow, you can feel it leaving. I considered it to be a curse.
Surely you would recognize the similarity of what happened to you and what happened to Michael at that age.
He's born with it, like I'm born with this. So maybe that's what he was asking. Well, June, how do you do it? You know, it's like, how do you live with it? How do you handle it? How do you? And I said, honey, we just have to do what we have to do. You know, and then we can fall apart later.
Where Michael Jackson came to get his soul back by reconnecting with someone who understood the Hollywood system, someone to help him make sense of what had happened to him in his life. In his last months, Jackson slept with a fading black and white photo next to his bed of a forgotten movie star.
Fatty Arbuckle was a star who was accused falsely of
raping a 14-year-old girl. And yes, he felt a close kinship.
I think that he had a picture of Fatty Arbuckle to remind him that he's not alone in the world. This ruined this guy. This same kind of thing ruined this guy, and there's a history of this in Hollywood.
Now Michael Jackson is dead, he's no longer in the way of his own career. Hollywood is in control, and the death agents have taken over to ensure his scandal-free future. Behind the smog, the secret support structure goes on, ready to shore up, protect and medicate the next generation of stars, whilst all the time serving its true master, Hollywood itself, who refused to be interviewed for this film.